the success stories obtained by machine learning methods in many disciplines have motivated several researchers to apply them on choice data. And this is a very good idea. In this video, we discuss the difference between the two approaches, and we also identify a couple of pitfalls that have to be avoided. The vocabulary of machine learning is different from the vocabulary that we use in discrete choice. Okay, so the relevant machine learning methodology for choice data is called supervised learning or classification. In this context, they partition the population into capital J classes. They consider a training set, which consists of features and the true class. They use a classifier that, given the features, predicts the class. And there are several types: logistic regression, super vector machine, decision trees, neural networks, and so on. I encourage you to Google some of them to know more about them. Well, basically, in discrete choice, we call the classes the alternatives and they form a choice set. The features, we call them explanatory variables. And the true class is the observed choice. The classifier, we call it a choice model. Given the explanatory variables, we predict the choice. And we also have different types of choice models. We have seen the logit, the nested logit, the mixtures, and so on. So there is a parallel between the two and a difference in vocabulary, but the concepts are similar. Machine learning has several advantages. First, in terms of model specification, when you do discrete choice, you have to handcraft manually somehow the specification. Usually you use simple specification, you use linear utility, you use relatively few interactions. In machine learning, they use complex functional form, and it's purely data-driven. You don't have to decide about the specification of the model. You just define the number of layers in a neural network, and the data will basically drive the model towards the final specification. In the course of the model development, with discrete choice, we do incremental improvement. We do trial and errors. We specify a simple model, then we increase the complexity, test the new one, and so on. Machine learning, it's systematic. You know, you provide the data, you provide the parameters of the algorithm, and everything is done systematically. The procedure for model selection is also quite different. In the context of discrete choice, we rely on statistical theory and hypothesis testing. While in the context of machine learning, out-of-sample validation is preferred. The model is trained on a training set, and then applied on a validation set containing data that has not been used for the training. And the validity of the model depends on the quality of the prediction the model performs on the validation set. There are some small pitfalls of machine learning for choice data that we have seen in the literature that are worth reporting. First, choice models by nature are probabilistic. So we calculate the probability that an individual performs a choice. So in terms of machine learning, it means that we would be interested in the probability that an item N belongs to a class I. And there are machine learning methods that are probabilistic, but several of them are also deterministic, so they perform a discrete classification. And when the underlying model is probabilistic, it's very common to see that the class which is labeled as the true class is the one associated with the highest probability. This is usually referred to as the optimal decision rule. But this is not correct, and we will see why. The reason is that it creates what I called an aggregation bias, and a severe one. Let's look at a simple example. Suppose that I have to classify 1,000 items into two classes. And I have a very simple data generation process that basically put 51% of the items into class 1 and 49% into class 2. And assume that I'm able to derive a machine learning model which is perfect. It really predicts correctly the data generation process. So 51%, 49%. But as commented in the previous slide, we apply the optimal decision rule and we say that the true class is the one associated with the highest probability. Therefore, when you aggregate, in reality, out of the 1,000 items, well, 510 will belong to class 1. But if you use the projection, the number of predicted items in class 1 will be 1,000. Okay, so in the context of aggregation, this may lead to very severe biases. And actually, the amplitude of this bias increases with the number of classes. So let's take the same example where I have to classify capital N items in capital K classes. And the data generation process that I assume here is that if you have K classes, each item has almost the same probability to be in each classes, except for class 1, which has a little bit higher probability than the other one. Okay, so it's almost the same probability, almost equal probability, except for class 1, which is a little bit higher. So you see the point. So the point is that when you do the projection, you will amplify a signal which basically is very small. So mathematically, I have the probability to be in class 1 equal to 1 plus epsilon capital K, and I can make epsilon as small as I want. And then every other class has this probability here, which is designed to be just a little bit below equal probability. And the sum over all classes is equal to 1. Again, suppose the machine learning model is perfect, so it's able to reproduce exactly the data generation process, but we apply this projection, where this optimal decision rule, where we select the highest probability class to be the true class. So in reality, the number of items in class 1 would be n times the probability. So this is the expected number. But the predicted one using our machine learning, our perfect machine learning model with the projection, would be capital N. And here you see that the error will increase with the number of classes, capital K. So this idea of projection may be acceptable at the disaggregate level. So if you have to do one classification. But we see in this example that when you aggregate the choices or the classifiers, you get a very significant bias that increases with the number of classes. So machine learning includes also probabilistic classification methods. Here are a few: Bayes classifiers, logistic regression, multi-layer perceptron. So there are toolboxes of probabilistic classification methods. This is fine. But the recommendation is that use the probability as an output for aggregation and not the projected 0-1 class membership. Another pitfall that has been documented in the PhD thesis by Tim Hillel is the use of machine learning methods on panel data. As I mentioned before, machine learning relies a lot on out-of-sample validation. And in this case, you split the data set between a training set and a validation set. And the idea is that the validation set contains data that have not been seen during estimation. But if you have panel data, the data associated with the same individuals are strongly correlated. It's the same individual. In particular, all the socioeconomic characteristics are exactly the same. So a mistake which is often done is that to prepare the validation set, the data are randomly selected across observations. But in this case, the validation set contains an information that the model has been exposed to during the training phase. And so it biases the process. So the right way to do it is to select data for the validation set based on the individuals and not based on observations. So in the literature, there are several examples where machine learning has been reported to be superior to discrete choice in prediction because the wrong validation set formation has been selected. It has been based on observations and not on individuals. And if you redo the analysis using the correct way of selecting the validation set, well, in this example, you observe that basically the machine learning method is performing almost as well as the discrete choice. There is not a big difference. So I refer you to the papers by Tim Hillel for the details, but this is important to keep in mind that you have to define properly the validation set for the machine learning method to be valid. In this video, we have introduced the use of machine learning methods to analyze choice data. We have discussed the aspects that make machine learning advantages, and we have identified some pitfalls that have been observed and should be avoided. In the next video, we emphasize the aspects to keep in mind when selecting one of the two methodologies, and in particular, we identify four aspects for which it is preferable to consider discrete choice models.